In this video, I'm going to be breaking down this animation shot from my latest video. I'm going to go over the different things I do in Clip Studio Paint, how I set up the layers, how I do coloring, and compositing for the final shot. And if you want to see the final animation, check out the Huion review video that I did before this one. Welcome to the Mind Palace. My name is SpyY. I am an animator, director, and creator of the series Welcome to the Mind Palace. This is an original anime series that we are producing on this channel, and I'm going to be breaking down to you one of these shots that I completed for a recent Huion tablet review video. And if you want to support our indie animation, Welcome to the Mind Palace, check out our Patreon link or the affiliate links in the description down below. So we're going to start off from the very beginning. A lot of people ask me how I set up my Clip Studio timeline. So first of all, the question that I get a lot is, what is the dimensions of your file and what is the DPI? Now, personally, I don't really know or necessarily care about the file size because I've worked with a whole bunch of different canvas sizes and they all basically function the exact same way. But for the purposes of this, I am recreating a template that I borrowed from the studio Tonari Animation. So they use a keyframe layout template like this, and the file size or the canvas size is going to be the exact same as the image. So this is just a PNG image that I imported into Clip Studio, and the canvas size is roughly the same as the paper. So in this case, 2048 by 1368. The DPI doesn't necessarily matter early on in the process. When I started this off, this DPI was actually at 72, and when I exported it, I upscaled it to 300 DPI just to make everything really high resolution for YouTube. Is all of this necessary? No, but I am following the anime production pipeline, so I am utilizing a lot of the things in this process, such as this black box here, which is the bounds for the camera, which is the 1920 by 1080 final resolution of the video, and anything that is drawn inside of this box is going to be shown on camera later on in the process. So let's take a look at what it looks like with the actual layout of the scene. So I'm going to lower the opacity just a tiny bit so you can see how this works. Like I mentioned, anything that is within the black box is going to show up on screen in the final shot. I basically broke this up into two layers. You've got layer A and layer B. Layer A represents the tablet, the lap that it is sitting on, and the chair. Although technically, if you want to go into specifics, the chair doesn't necessarily count as a layer, but that's for another day. And layer B, which is on top of layer A, which is the arm, the hand, and the shadow. Now, to put it simply, you want to stack it like a paper. So layer A is going to be the piece of paper that is furthest away from your camera or your eyeballs. And so that's why A is always at the bottom. So in this case, the tablet would be A1. So that's the first frame in the timeline, and because it's circled, this represents a key frame. So basically, this would be one of the more important drawings in the process. And I have the word end here because this is a notation that is used to represent the end of a sequence. And so if we look at my timeline, layer A is only showing on frame one, and it's just held for the rest of the sequence. Layer B is stacked on top of layer A like a paper. Now, this, of course, represents the hand, but you can see as I scrub through the timeline, the numbers actually do change as we go. So we've got B1, we've got 1A, which is sort of an in-between breakdown frame that I've notated. You've got 2, 2A, 3, 3A, 4, 5, and 6. Now, to answer a bunch of questions, because there's a lot on the screen, if you look here, you can see that 1A is notated with a triangle. Triangles, as I've been told, usually represent breakdowns. I've also seen them referred to as in-betweens. Depends on which part of the process or if you're using actual notation, but I typically use it as breakdowns. And you can see that I have not drawn the entire thing. At this rough stage, I'm really just trying to focus on getting the motion of the hand to be pretty much in line with the keyframes. So in this case, B2 and B1 are drawn completely, and 1A is sort of in between these two frames. And so I want to make sure that they look good, but I don't want to focus too much on the details this early. You may also notice that I have these little circles here. So this is actually something that a lot of my mutuals did not know existed. These are known as in-between labels. So essentially what you do is you go into this little hamburger menu here, you click on label, and then you can see you have these two options called create in between track label, and then you've got a hollow circle and a solid circle. Now you also have the option of creating timeline labels and track labels, and the timeline labels in this case are just these green flags that I put on top. This is just another form of label that you can use, but basically, yeah, there's a lot of ways that you can notate things on the actual timeline to make things a lot easier for yourself visually. You still with me so far? Hopefully. I've been rambling for a bit. Anyways, this is the basis of the layout shot. I'm just trying to rough out how the actual shot is going to look without putting too much effort into the details. And because I've made an entire video about this, I'm not going to explain fully what the red and blue lines mean or what the colors mean. Go check out the video in the card right now. All right, so from the layout stage, we're going to be focusing on the first key animation. This is essentially where I take all the lines and I basically polish as much as I can. So if I were to compare this to the previous layout keyframes, you can see that I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, where previously I had 1, 1A, 2, 2A. So essentially, these are now my keyframes. Let's actually hide this so that it's easier to see. But you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 keyframes, and then I'm gonna have to draw stuff in between that to make it smoother. Let's also do a quick breakdown of the actual file structure that I use. So looking at the layers here, I've got what is known as a keyframe folder. Now, a lot of people, when they set keyframes, they usually have it as a single image. So in this case, if I were to do an example here, if I create a frame here as frame 10 and set the frame here, I can draw on this and this would be another frame in the sequence. But what people don't know is that you can actually set a folder as your keyframe and then you can layer files inside of it in order to make things a lot more organized. So as you can see, for every single one of my keyframes, I've got three specific layers. I've got the top layer, which is the black line art layer. You can see it hiding and showing as we go. You've got the middle layer, which I was going to use to fill in colors. And then you've got the bottom layer, which is the red and blue lines on the layer. Essentially, the way that that works is that later on in the process, I am going to be needing these red and black lines to be separate so that I can actually fill in the solid colors later on. So the next stage after that is the in-between stage. This is where you take all of the frames and literally draw in between each of them in order to make a smooth final motion. So if we zoom in on the timeline here, you've got the hand layer, and I specifically drew 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. But my animator Ampharox took this shot and basically drew this 1A frame in between. So normally the first two frames would go 1, 2, 1, 2. It kind of jumps. You can see that? You can see that it jumps from here to here. But if we re-enable that keyframe, it goes 1, 1A, 2. And you can see that it is a slightly smoother motion. And so what I had them do is I notated which frames they're going to be drawing, and then I literally just set them loose and they drew all of the frames to make it one smooth motion. So if I were to just play the timeline here, it's a very smooth motion compared to what it was before. Now, a quick thing to note, because people are going to ask, is that this is animated on 2s and 3s. What does that mean? It means that keyframe 1 is going to be exposed for 2 frames, 1A is going to be on for 2 frames, 2 for 2 frames, 2A for 3 frames, 3 for 3 frames, and so on and so forth. This is what's known as limited animation, and it's actually a key part of the anime style in Japan. And so by using less frames, not only does it make it easier on the animators, but it also allows me to be more creative with less frames. And it still looks like a smooth animation in post-production. So I'm going to skip ahead a couple of steps and kind of show you what the compositing stage looks like. So if we take a look here, I actually separated the shadow into its own layer because I wanted to make sure that it was composited separately from the actual work. Let's take a look at what the hand looks like in the actual file structure. So as you can see, we've got this top line here, which is for the black line art. Next, underneath that, if I were to hide the color layer, we have, again, the separated colored lines, the red lines and the blue lines. And then in between that, you have the color lines. Now, of course, the shadow is its own thing on its own separate layer, so ignore the lines on the outside. But you can see as I hide the color layer that since it's sandwiched between the black line art and the color trace lines, this allows me to just color everything in without any gaps, and I know exactly where the limits of the shading go. Of course, it's not perfect, but in a cel-shaded style like this, it's perfectly fine. And this is what everything looks like just on its own, which already looks pretty good. I've got some additional color correction on the bottom layer, stuff like this shadow or this multiply layer on the skirt, just to give things a little bit more depth. And similarly, with the top layer for the hand, I've got a multiply layer, which gives it some shading depth over here, and I've got an add layer on the top left, which gives it just a little bit of light. You can see it better as I scrub to the right, but you can definitely see that this looks a lot better than just this. Then all I gotta do is go back and add the original background layer, and then some additional lighting effects, like this glow effect that you see in a lot of anime. You got some shading over here to give it some depth, and this is pretty much a finished composited shot from start to finish in Clip Studio Paint. So if I were to just lower the opacity of this ever so slightly, again, you can see that in the final animation, there is going to be this camera border, and I actually do zoom into this in the final animation. So if I were to show you what the export folder looks like, I basically exported each and every frame in the full resolution. So the full whatever it was, I exported it at the full 2048 by 1368. This allows me to do some interesting shots in post-production, such as zooming in and out, or scrolling left to right, or in my case, just keeping it still but zoomed in so that it looks nice. And really, the only thing I had to do left was import this entire image sequence into my video editor, and then it was basically done. That was that entire shot. There's a lot more that I can go into this, but that would require an extensive overview of the entire anime production process. But if you guys want to learn more about my process, learn more about the things that I do, the choices that I make when working with a team, such as splitting up shots, how I organize shots, check out the video that you see on screen. Or if you want to watch the finished animation from this Hueon review video, check out the other video that's linked on screen. And once again, if you guys want to support an indie animation such as myself, check out the Patreon link in the description below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video.